So welcome everyone to Philadelphia Net Tuesday, by Philly Net Square. How many people is this the first time we've been here? So about half. Okay, great. We're going to be doing a format we've done before, and Dennis can talk a little more about that. We're going to skip just a couple of quick remarks about what's happening here. There are Net Square groups around the world. This one is the Philadelphia Net Square group. They all have different nuances. They're not officially affiliated in any organizational sense. And they tend to organize around a certain theme. In our case, we tend to use the phrase, using the social web for social change. It's rather broad and self-defined in terms of how people think of that. But generally, it seems to have attracted the kinds of programs we put on and the kinds of people who seem to react to that from either a technical point of view or an activist point of view or a nonprofit point of view. One of the activities that we do, the main activity, are these Net Tuesdays, which happen on the first Tuesday of every month. We also have a website, which I see has a typo in it, but that's just to test people. It's, as you would predict, it would be spelled, not how it's spelled there, so don't click on that. We also have a Google group for a listserv, which goes through various different ebbs and flows of activity, and sometimes provides some really useful help and assistance for people. The past several Net Tuesday we've provided are kind of displayed here. You can see there's a variety of different sorts of topics. Basically, we try to come up with a topic that seems of interest or that someone wants to explore. And a couple of these have been topics that someone who's come to the group, they've wanted to explore it a little more deeply. They thought that it was something important to them. And we've supported trying to create an event that enabled them to be able to produce it. Coming up, next week there's a planning meeting. Anyone's invited to that? See myself or Ivan, if you're interested in that. Ivan, raise your hand. Ivan and myself are the organizers of this event. Next month, on May 3rd, the event is going to be do-it-yourself education. Eric, do you want to say anything about that?
Sure, we're going to be looking at self-directed learning and knowledge sharing through the use of technology, exploring open textbooks, sites like P2P University, Udemy. So we're going to be exploring all that with some guest speakers.
Next month, we're going to repeat a format we did on our last year, our second anniversary, which is Social Web Sampler, in which people in the Philadelphia Net Square community, all of you and other people who are not here, are invited to choose a topic that they either feel some kinship to, some expertise about, or some affinity for that has to do with the social web. And we'll have kind of a little unconference about it. We'll have actually 15 sessions and three different time slots, five simultaneous, for 20-minute sessions where we'll be able to focus on one or another of these social web topics. It's an interesting format, and you'll be getting more information about that. In addition to the monthly meetings, we're also about networking, because this is a big field, and it's always changing, and no one knows everything, and we need to learn a lot from each other. So there's a couple of mechanisms we have to try and facilitate the networking that we're about here, and one of them is a sign-in sheet, so if you haven't signed in, please do so. We'll take that information, we'll send it back out to everyone, along with a scan of your business cards. So leave a business card. If you don't have a business card, or if you're unsure of your identity, there are blank business cards there, and you're welcome and invited to fill in a blank business card, which could be instead of or in addition to your normal identity. We really aren't going to judge the We also have tags. People are tagging themselves, not only with their name, but also with something, in this case, about what you're looking forward to with the warm weather. You're invited to look at people's tags and open up a conversation with them. Everyone wants to be able to meet some other people, and this is an opportunity to do it. And no questions too stupid should be assumed. In addition to the event that we're having right here in the room, we're also streaming this live on the internet, And there are people who are watching it right now through that camera. There's a camera there. This is being controlled by Harry back there right now. It's also being recorded, and we'll put it up on our website afterwards. In addition to streaming it outward, use a Twitter hashtag, PHLNET2. And so we're inviting people who are out on the web, as well as perhaps in this room, if they want to tweet something with that hashtag, we'll go into the Twitter stream. And so people who are remote are able to make comments, ask questions, and actually participate in the event that's happening right here. Ivan is monitoring the Twitter channel back there, and we'll introduce any additional questions or comments into the room as appropriate. Okay, quick housekeeping stuff. There's food. Please eat it all, because we don't want to bring it back. We don't have anyone to bring it back. The bathrooms are outside on the other side of the elevators. We have Wi-Fi access in this building. It's open access. You don't need a password or anything. If you park in the lot across 15th Street, you can get 20% off. Just go to the front desk with your parking stub, and you'll get validated for a discount. And you're invited to go back and look over Ivan's shoulder at the Twitter stream if you're not familiar with it, or to look over Harold's shoulder over there to see about how the stream works, how this room works. And, it's an informal sort of thing. So please feel free to get up and walk around. I don't think people will be insulted. Please don't be insulted if people get up. We made sure there's a little space in the back of the room so you can walk back to get to the food without anyone walking in front of people. And we're just trying to be informal and quickly also. Our sponsor for the evening is the American Friends Service Committee, which is one of the tenants in this building. This building is actually part of a 3-4 building campus called the Friends Center, which houses a number of mostly Friends, Quaker-related organizations. The American Friends Service Committee is one of those, and is an international nonprofit that deals with social justice and peace issues around the world. So, good folks, and please find out more about them. What we're going to do right now is we're just going to do a quick go-around of introductions. People can just say what their name is and perhaps something about why they're here. Very quickly, we'll try and go through it, and then we'll get underway with the program. So, my name is Seth Horvitz. I'm a consultant in areas of knowledge management and social capital under the name of CommuniShare, and I consult a lot here with the American Friends Service Committee, hence Access to Learn. And these are just wonderful events for me to try and keep up with what's going on in this whole very fast-moving world, and couldn't give up. But
I'm Felicia Caviezel. I'm the Director of Youth Programming here at the American Friends Service Committee, and I'm here to always learn how we can connect better with youth through social media.
I'm Madar Gable. I work with a couple of groups. One is called Big Picture Small World. It does educational programs around the world for colleges and corporations and even high schools. And another one is called Earth Game, which is doing a giant dashboard for the Earth, that the first version of which will be installed in New York at the UN. There'll also be a website, and which is also was aided and abetted by some interaction at this forum about, what, a year ago? More than a year ago.
Bedard was one of the beneficiaries of the first crowdsourcing change time we did this forum about a year ago, and he came back. So, obviously, one other thing I wanted to say was, because of the sound that we're trying to both recording and streaming out, we're not using extra mics to pass around, but we want people to speak up clearly, and it would actually be helpful if, when you introduce yourself, you just stand up so the people around the room can hear you.
My name is Thomas Taylor. I work for the Greater Philadelphia Cultural Alliance, and I've been coming to Manchester off and on for a long time. I have a slightly ulterior motive this evening to mention the first ever Philly Civa CRM meetup. So if you're interested in databases, you can grab a flyer from that table for me.
I'm Nathan Solomon. I'm with a company called Superfluid, and we help people collaborate on unpaid projects.
Hey, I'm Meredith Dolan. I'm an events coordinator at the Academy of Natural Sciences, and I'm here to learn more about how I can use social media with my events.
Hi, I'm Heidi Univer. I do social media, new media strategy for a small rabbinical college, actually, in Waco, code, and I particularly enjoy the crowdsourcing meetings for finding out how to do things better.
I'm Anita McCalvey. I own Authentic Philadelphia, which is a subset of my other business, which is Day Trips and More, which is a cultural heritage tourism business. With Authentic Philadelphia, I consult with nonprofits and help them do their marketing, especially with regards to historic preservation and any kind of cultural heritage projects. I'm here to learn more about social media. We do use a certain amount of it.
Hi, my name is Vitali Jagannathan. I run a business consulting and writing business called Itinerant Inc. And I do primarily fundraising consulting and which is for nonprofits. And I'm just here because it sounds like a fascinating event.
My name is Georgia. I'm here representing the Hackery, and we promote use of technology in the arts. I'm here to figure out how we can just get the word out more about our programs and have more name recognition.
I'm Deidre Krieger. I'm a marketing and communication specialist, and I'm also an artist and curator, and I currently have a show up called Let's Play Nice, and I'm interested in social media. It's like an obsession.
Hi, I'm Marta. I run a research center at Annenberg School for Communication at the University of Pennsylvania, but I'm also helping to start a food co-op in Kensington, and we're trying to use social media to reach the population there, which is challenging and interesting. So, I'm here to learn more.
I'm Johanna Levitt. I'm a social worker. I work for two nonprofits for mental health issues, and I'm here to learn because I love to learn.
Hi, Mitch Collier. I work for a small government contractor. We do health communications, policy analysis, and I'm also a long ago veteran of the Academy of Natural Sciences and Environmental Research. And for that, as a volunteer in the botany department, I encourage anyone to go see what's available for volunteering opportunities at the Academy. It's a great experience.
Hi, I'm Gloria Bell. I'm the founder and owner of Brent Stapler Consulting. We do social media and marketing consulting for small businesses, nonprofits, organizations. Also the president of Social Media Club, and there's always something new to learn in this field, and so the sharing like this helps us all learn.
Hi, my name is Gershon. I'm Gordon. I'm from South Africa. I'm here on the cultural exchange visa, and I'm working at a campsite called Kirkwood in the Poconos. And I like to learn more about social media. That's why I'm here.
My name is Mary. I am in public relations and marketing, and I find this stuff fascinating, and that's why I'm here.
It's Andrew Safer. I'm one of the assistant directors at a small ball library across town, and I always show up to these events. They're usually a good time, and I always learn something.
Hello, I'm Mark Kingsley. I do video production and distribution consulting, so I'm here to learn a little bit more about crowdsourcing and how video can play a part in that.
Hi, I'm Paul Forrest. I work with an organization called Power of Gambia, which puts solar installations in hospitals in West Africa. And we have a crowdsourcing and crowdfunding campaign going right now that's been installing, so I'm interested in learning more about the internet go forward. And I also work with the William Way LGBT Community Center.
Hi, I'm Mike Figgins, fullstories.org, and I'm just here to learn more about social media.
Hello, I'm Craig DeMarge. I'm a marketer, educator, and career coach, and I'm interested in applications of social media to mental health and diabetes education, and so looking forward to learning some things related to that.
Hi, I'm Nathan Gosser of a company called Dr. Star. We do web development consulting, social justice, and nonprofit and education. Higher ed kinds of organizations. I'm always interested in learning new things and meeting new folks, and I'm looking forward to doing some more kayaking.
Hi,
Hi, my name is Emily Slater. I'm with the Envision Peace Museum. We're a young museum, and we're just getting in the heat, and we'd like to use social networking to help us.
I'm Jane Reimold. I'm with a small nonprofit in Upper Darby, and I'm our Facebook administrator, and really would love to know more and more, so I'm really glad to be here.
I'm Ivan. I do consulting under the name Rootwork. I work mostly with Casino Free Philadelphia here in Philly and also the Fellowship of Reconciliation. And I'm one of the people that helps put these together. And I'm looking forward to hearing from these great organizations tonight.
My name is Ron Emmerich, and my career has always been in mostly historic preservation nonprofit organizations, now working with arts groups as well. And fascinated with the whole concept of using social networking and particularly crowdfunding.
Hi, I'm Dan. I'm with Hotel Grants. We are a new crowdfunding site that allows nonprofits as well as individuals themselves raise funds for socially beneficial projects focusing on the high school and college space.
Hi, I'm Marion Quinn. I'm here because Seth let me know that today is Tuesday and not Monday. And now that I'm here, I'm hoping I can learn a lot from where I volunteer, which is Tri-State Bird Rescue. And now that they're on the map, from the worldwide map, from the Gulf Spillways Bonds, they have a real big interest in the social media world. Not a lack of presence, so I'm hoping I can learn something for them.
I'm David Sternberg. I'm with Philly for Change, which is the Philadelphia affiliate of Democracy for America, which grew out of Dean for America, Howard Dean's campaign, which is still active. And also in my day job, I do communications work with the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency.
My name is Eric Smith. I'm an online educator for Philadelphia OIC's Digital Initiative Program.
John James, I'm working on a project that I call Rep Accounts, and that's to make it easier to get paid for digital work online. It's repaccounts.org.
Hello, I'm Harold Pugh. I work for the American Friends Service Committee here. I get to work with Seth quite often and also get to play with all the nice toys here.
My name is Lamar Kendrick, and I work with a group of people. We go by the name EDO Ventures. We help business owners raise money and transfer ownership. That's my day job. Otherwise, I'm involved in an effort to create community. Particularly interested in creating it socially, online and offline. In fact, the Chemical Heritage Foundation is one of the locations or facilities where the Hub Meeting and Event Centers, which I'm affiliated with, organizes meetings. Another is at 30th Street Station at Sarah Center, and we have a third at 17th and Sansom at the City View, which is located in the United Plaza building. So I'm here because I'm interested in the notion of creating community, both online.
My name is Mills Chapman, and I'm designing day schools for the children of opposing political groups overseas in tech conflicts. Help one school for the kids, the two opposing groups can help resolve the conflict, beginning with one Cyprus, divided Nicosia.
I'm Becky Steele. I work for the American Friends Service Committee. I'm implementing a new volunteer program for the AFSC, and so I'm really interested in learning more about how we can use the web to support our volunteer work. I also invite any of you that want to volunteer for us to come.
Okay, so I think that's everyone in the crowd. I'm going to pass it over to Denny, and we can get started.
Okay, I'm Denny Casrael. I do web communication strategy. And sometimes I say, depending on who I'm talking to in my other life, I also happen to be an arts and culture writer. So if any of you recognize my name through that, so I indulged myself a little bit with this lineup, and I thought it would be good also to have that, you know, sure that everyone feels they're all worthy, but I was very happy that the different applications that we got just happened to fall into categories that were of interest. Just a couple of things about how tonight works, because a lot of you are new. It's pretty simple. Each of the presenters gets 10 minutes to basically tell what they do, what they're about, their mission, what they're trying to accomplish, and then they'll show some of what they're doing on their social media efforts. And then we open the floor up to the crowd, and basically, are we going to be showing the questions in between or not?
Okay.
All right. If not, I'll be there. There were three questions. If you saw when we had the announcement of the actual event, there was at least three questions that they put out. Of course, there'll be many more things that will come across when they're talking, but there are a number of questions that they had indicated that they wanted to address. So we'll just open that up, the floor, and then anybody who has any suggestions with regard to those questions or anything that you see or any ideas you have in your head that gets stimulated by what they're talking about, that's what it's all about. So that's basically how it works. And I'll just give a little brief introduction on your optics, because I'm going to look at this a little bit. The Academy of Natural Sciences, first of all, is there anyone in the room here who does not know the Academy of Natural Sciences? Okay. How about the Painted Bright Art Center? Okay. All right. Well, the Painted Bright Art Center is an art and culture center in Old City. They have programming for music, jazz, world music, theater, dance, theater, performance art, video. They have an art gallery. They're a lot about diversity and tolerance and, just sharing different world cultures and things of that nature. They have workshops and residencies and all kinds of things just to kind of get the juices, creative juices flowing and getting cultures mixing and things of that nature. The Chemical Heritage Foundation. So the Chemical Heritage Foundation fosters an understanding of chemistry. It has collections, scientific and instruments, fine art photographs, papers, books. They host conferences, lectures, they support research, they have fellowships, they produce educational materials. And this is the year of chemistry, is it this year?
Yes.
So I don't know how many people will do that, but this is the International Year of Chemistry. And so they're helping to promote that. And just I want to remind people, if you're tweeting, that our hash is PHLNET2. And since we're going to... Just as a clarification, so I'm pretty strict about the 20 minutes, so don't think that I'm like a dictator up here, but we're trying, just so you know, we want to fit three people in. So if there's still hands up and, we just can't have everybody be able to get in, say, for the Academy or for Painted Bright or the Chemical Heritage, please afterwards, just they'll still be here, come up and have conversations afterwards. We do have time for everybody to be able to network and mingle after the fact. But I'm going to be pretty rigid about the 20 minutes, so just don't be offended if your hands still raised and I don't have an opportunity to call on you. And if I don't call on you for one of the people, please, raise your hand again. Then take it personally, but just let you understand that, because in the last couple of times that we've had this, we really, there's been so much feedback, we really haven't been able to have everyone's feedback be able to be a part of each particular segment. So, without further ado, you're up first, Academy of Natural Sciences, and this is Dennis Murphy and Mike Savidia.
I'm Dennis Murphy, and I'm the web monkey at the Academy of Natural Sciences. Our main site, recently rebranded. Still have several hundred pages to go in terms of rebranding. This is a static site, driving me crazy. And one of the things I'm planning to do this year is move over to the Drupal content management system. And there are several people here I know that work with it. It has certain social media capabilities within it, and certainly not loud enough
Right. If you could speak up, that would be great.
Okay. Is it going to be a problem for me?
Is this all right, sir?
Could he talk here?
Yeah, if you want. You
want us to stand here?
Okay.
Or I'll give you one to hold.
Or I'll just watch him.
Maybe this was the case.
Okay. Is this better? How about that? I have a hearing deficit, so I don't know how loud I'm talking. Anyway, I'm very interested in moving over to Drupal and moving several of our sub-sites, including the Center for Environmental Policy, which right now we're using a WordPress blog, which is totally insufficient for the type of things we want to serve there. My colleague Mike Servideo will be doing discussing most of the social media stuff. I think I'll leave let you do most of the talking for that right now.
Okay, I'm going to talk from here. If you can't hear me, just yell. My name is Mike. I do all of the social media at the Academy now, which is a job that I inherited about 2 weeks ago when one of my other colleagues left. I had been helping out with it for the last couple of months, but now it is all mine. So one of the things I inherited was our Twitter account, and I have to be honest with you guys, I don't like Twitter as a personal user, and I'm still learning how to use it in a professional manner. And one of the big questions I have for everybody here is, what should I be tweeting about? I think one of my major goals using the social media at the Academy is to really explore the science that happens at the Academy. I'm sure that most of you guys have been there. You've enjoyed the museum, you know about the dinosaur bones, you know about the animal dioramas, but you probably don't know about the three floors of scientists that we have, except for the gentleman that volunteered. You probably know a lot about the botany department. So I'd love to know what I should be tweeting about to let people know about the science in the museum. Our Facebook page is another thing that I've inherited, and I'm trying to do the same thing with that. I've been somewhat successful recently with posts. Never mind.
Do you want to show your insights?
I'm sorry?
Would you like to show your insights?
My insights?
On your Facebook page, it might help us help you.
Okay.
And you don't have to.
I'll get back to you.
This is where the crowdsourcing comes
in. Yes. I'm pretty new to a lot of this stuff. This is why I'm here. I'm mostly here to listen to you guys. And just let me show you the one last tool that I have for social media, which is our e-newsletter, which is something that I've been doing for about a year now. And I'm curious to know what people are expecting out of an e-newsletter. What segments people are interested in using. Sorry, what did you ask me about with Facebook?
I'm sorry, I didn't want to interrupt your presentation.
That's okay.
Do you know what Facebook Insights are?
No, I don't.
Okay, as the administrator of this site, you have access to an analytics tool that's pretty crude, but it
yes, I do know what it's
would show you know your traffic and.
If I just log in, I should come up with.
Right. Well, you'd have to click on it, but yeah.
So while you're doing that, one thing I would offer when you put the question of. What should I be tweeting or newslettering or whatever? Well, the beauty of the medium is you can ask. So that's kind of the first thing. Just tweet and ask people who are following you. What do you want to hear about? What more, what different would you like us to tweet about?
Okay.
So you're actually crowdsourcing people's interests, and then that gives you guidance around what people are interested in.
How many people follow you now?
Okay. Oh, I'm just going to ask if we could just hold off. I'm sorry to say, I'm very strict about this. That's why they have me do this, because I do it. So please.
So don't answer his question.
So just, I'm sorry. We just want to be, it's a very defined time that they have for the presentation, and just to be fair to everybody. So just make notes, whatever you want to talk about, and then we'll get to those things. But go ahead.
Okay. sorry, I lost my train of thought. The things I wanted to know about Facebook, easy questions. The person I inherited this from used to change the profile picture maybe once a month. Is that an effective tool? I've used a little bit on the tab end of things. We've had some other tabs that I've deleted recently. I don't know what it's called. It's just a tab that you can insert HTML into. That I've been using a little bit, but it's been kind of funky because it apparently doesn't recognize CSS. I'm working around that right now. How do I get to the insights?
So view insights on the right third link down. Go down, down, down. Right there.
There we go. Yeah. Okay, I think...
Right before you married Alice.
Okay.
So that... And that can just show you patterns of when people are coming on, and you know if you do something has an effect. I'm sorry, I need to
I don't know how much more that I was going to say, so we want.
All right. Well, let's. Why don't when you'll show your site too? But I just want to make something that brings me to the industry, because when I originally wrote the write-up, even on the tab, I forgot the diagrams, because I mean I still remember the RAM that you have there, right, but. The Academy really does a lot of things. They are a research institute. On top of that, they do a lot of things with environmental, right, environmental programs. They have a research center. So I mean, the public part is what we all see. Plus, you've got all your programming, like movies and all sorts of things. So just as part of our discussion, we can just think about that they have a number, like who would you say were your audiences? You know, it's not simply just the public that come to see the museum, correct?
I think it's other scientists,
yeah.
It's other researchers, it's people with specific interests in environmental science.
There's also people that are just interested in the natural world that
right.
They want to engage.
Okay, and then as far as your, you want to just talk just a little bit about your program, you have a research program in that part, because I think those are the areas that might be helpful for people to also understand that you have sort of this behind the scenes activity that maybe is not as, obviously it's behind the scenes, so it's not as visible, but that you could make more visible through, or, you know, at least get some conversation about through social media.
Okay. I'll explain some of the activities. We have two broad research groups. One is biodiversity, classic natural history type of research, often involving evolutionary relationships among organisms. And we're also caring for collections related to these organisms. We have approximately 18 million specimens that we're caring for right now. Very important for other scientists. Am I loud enough for her?
No.
No, not at all. Okay. Biodiversity work, we have 18 million specimens. A lot of other scientists need this access to this stuff. The environmental research, we do consulting and original research, often for organizations like governments like the EPA, government agencies like EPA, water center associations, state of New Jersey, all that kind of stuff. We have a public program series with the Center for Environmental that you give up.
okay.
Yes.
Doesn't sound loud here. Center for Environmental Policy hosts both working groups and public programs relating to issues of sustainability. Some of you may have heard of the Urban Sustainability Forum or Town Square programs. We have those. We have educational programs. We're trying to branch out into being a resource for teachers to learn about science. And we found through our member events that a lot of our members just love interacting with the scientists. So we may want to be exploring that avenue in the future.
Okay. All right. And do you want to just put your site back up now while we're here? Okay. All right. Now we're going to open up the questions. I'm just going to read the three questions that families have posted. And if anything that you've heard or if anything that you see here, you notice anything, and again, the questions that you were starting to come out with when I had to temporarily cut you off here, please bring them back. But the three questions that they have are, how can we use social media to better communicate who we are and what we do? And as we already see that there are areas that are sort of, you know, kind of hidden that a lot of people don't understand or know that the Academy is involved in. Okay, how should we differentiate what we post on Facebook and Twitter? That's a very common type of question that people have. And we've got lots of people here that I'm sure that can speak to that. And then what social media considerations should we make for our main website, which we are currently converting to a Drupal content management system? If there's people in this crowd that are Drupal people. So I'll just open it up and go ahead, Nate.
Number one, you said, what should we tweet? I suggest you follow Neil deGrasse Tyson, who's a director of the Hayden Planetarium in New York.
Okay.
He's a great model for what a science organization could tweet about. And one of the things is he ties science to current events all the time. So he'll say something about how the moon is affecting the tsunami or whatever. You know, so it's things that are relevant to people, especially the way Twitter works is people who are, you know, people who are following you already follow you, but people also search on hashtags or on just words. So if you put some interesting piece of information that doesn't have words that people are searching for, they're not going to see it. But when people search for things like tsunami or Libya or whatever, if you have information that relates from a natural sciences perspective to something in current events, you're going to be found by people who are interested in that phenomenon, and they'll maybe learn the natural sciences component of that. So that's one thing. Neil deGrasse Tyson's great at doing that, so maybe follow him a little bit. Second, you asked, should we change your Facebook picture? I would say no, because you look at your feed and you see those icons and they register with who they are. So I wouldn't change that. And real quickly, the last one, I would integrate the Facebook like feature. It helps, it shows other users, or it shows when I come to your website, I can find out things that other people that I follow on Facebook are looking at on your website. So kind of we talked about sort of extending the community of interested people into the community of the scientists that are doing the research and sharing information. That's a good way of kind of sharing that. So.
First, the question about what should you tweet about. One of the things that I think is huge for you is you are a museum. Everything is very visual. So periodically walk through the museum, find something a little different, and take a picture, tweet the picture. Get people intrigued by things they might not see or might not think about being in the museum. And as far as differentiating what you post on Facebook and Twitter, in your case, I would go a little more activities heavy on your Facebook and periodically cross-post between the two. I wouldn't cross-post every single thing, but I would do, like, especially your event stuff, upcoming events you have, other, you know, special things, special exhibits. I would make sure you're posting on both. And, as far as communicating who you are, what you do, I love the suggestion of crowdsourcing. Find out what people want to know. What is the one thing they're not hearing from you that they would like to hear from you? You know, it's great to ask your audience, what do you want to know? What do you want us to talk about? Because what happens then is when you share with them what they want to talk about, what they want to hear from you, they're going to share it with other people.
I'll go around the room and get to you.
As far as the differentiation question, I kind of raise this whether you have distinct audiences that you're trying to reach and whether maybe there should be separate Twitter streams for those audiences. Facebook, I think that's more of a general interest, but as far as Twitter, maybe you have more one Twitter stream that's more tech or more science oriented, and another one that's more family oriented, family event oriented. That's kind of, not that there isn't an intermingling of the two, but capital. I don't know if they'll be successful in that, but one thing to look at.
All right.
I'm a huge fan of your sustainability forum. I've been to a bunch. I think you could really tap into that. It's a really rich stream. You know, you could make sure the people that go to it know about the continuation of the dialogue that you're going to have at certain, you know, at an online place, at Facebook. Maybe invite the people who are presenting at the Sustainability Forum to participate in that. But you've got a gold mine there of potential interactivity that can be very useful.
Three things. Do you interact with your membership office at all, trying to get your members on Facebook?
I actually am the membership office as well.
Oh, okay. My second thing is, I've been all over your website, and I did not know you had three floors of scientists. That's an awesome thing that maybe you would have a tab that's for professionals with a login or something, just for that information. I mean, that's pretty awesome. The third thing is, to become a resource, the Pennsylvania Department of Education has environmental themes or topics that they have to cover over the school year or grade school or middle school. And I ran a bookstore at the Schuylkill Center, and what I did was I had books on those topics, and they sold like hotcakes because there's not that much around. So maybe you could do something with those things from the education department on resources that the academy has.
I would encourage you to find out as much as you can about who is following you on Twitter and who is friending you or liking you on Facebook, because if they're the same audience, you would use a different strategy than if they're really different sets of people. So, who's following you, who else do they follow, dig into the insights. You said that the people really love interacting with the scientists, so I thought perhaps once a month you could take one scientist, feature them on Twitter, and invite people to tweet questions.
Yeah, we've done that a little bit before.
And then that scientist would, you know, they're not giving detailed answers, but they could point people to papers they've published, exhibits, places in the museum, things like that, and it could build excitement around sort of, you can even make that a premium if you join, you get to participate in that Twitter encounter with the scientists. You could also be tweeting with the press in mind, because a lot of journalists are now following things that related to their beat on Twitter. And following up on Nathan's point about not changing your Facebook image, one of the recent changes that Facebook has made is you can now comment as your page on other pages. So you want to have that identity, and you could go on other pages where potential fans may be lurking and, you know, comment on their content. You don't want to be obnoxious about, you know, putting your billboard on someone else's page, but you can certainly engage with their content as the academy and then bring people back.
Just a few other recommended museum Twitterers to follow. The Exploratorium in San Francisco does a good job of relating their exhibits to current events. And then a couple sort of non-science museums, the American History Museum of the Smithsonian does a great job also of that relating to current events. And the Brooklyn Museum does a lot of like interactive sort of, you know, talking to people, curators of the museum, and a lot of back and forth. So some other suggestions there.
I'm writing an article for Tri-State's newsletter about bird nests. One of the things that came across was an article that interviewed the curator of the specimens collection at Harvard, and he was talking about how important those specimens were in being able to compare the DNA, you would say, in eggshells from 200 years ago, and that helped to determine that DDT was causing the thinning of bird eggs. So similar to, I guess his name is Nathan, like, I never knew that about specimens. To me, there are things in drawers that collect dust, and nobody, you know what I mean? Like, if you can cross-pollinate between what your researchers are finding out through these specimens that nobody understands with your teachers or your students or whomever, like what are they doing currently, what are they learning, how are they using them? Just that, like a theme like that of cross-pollinating between the different audiences, what can one learn from the other, what can one teach the other, that kind of thing. I learned a lot just from reading that one article about how important these things were, and you've got a whole collection of them.
I don't know if you thought about Flickr as well. I just checked out about 2,800 photos tagged for Academy of Natural Sciences, which will help. So maybe think about how you might use some of those photographs maybe on your site or tweet about a particularly good one.
Yeah, I was also just thinking that as we were talking about this question of differentiating between Facebook and Twitter. And, you know, there's sort of, in certain ways, they're emerging and some people say Facebook is more interactive and more visual, and so that's where you put your videos and your photos, and Twitter is sometimes considered more, but that's depending on how you use it. If you're doing a chat or more announcements leading them to your site, I mean, both of them can lead them to it. But as far as Facebook goes, like you're mentioning the photos, you can create some albums, you know, and then you could put them on Facebook. It's not as easy to do. I mean, you could create it on your site and tweet about it on Twitter, and then they would go to it. But on Facebook, you could have different albums that are there. So if someone were to go, and they go to one, and they'll see the other. So that's just, you know, one way that those two types of social media platforms have some level of differentiation. And the other thing with Facebook is, unless you're having the chat where people are, say, following a hashtag, everyone will see all the comments bunched together. So sometimes if you want to have that kind of conversation where everybody's going to be able to see all the feedback at once, sometimes, you know, Facebook sometimes lends itself a little more to that. So I'm just picking that up as some ways that, as platforms, that they sort of interact differently with the people who are using them. But, you know, there's many different strategies on that. So anything else for Deanna? Oh, no, sorry.
Oh. It might be much too simplistic, but I was thinking of another way possibly to engage people directly with the scientists and make them feel part of the science, is if there's any way that people can be gathering data and tweeting it in. You know, if you ask a question, how many such and such birds have you seen this month, or how, you know, when did your crocuses come up this year versus last year, whatever it might be, that, you know, fishermen, I know you, there's a tremendous amount of, is it ichthyology going on there? So if there are any ways that people can feel like they are part of the process of the science without, you know, being fake about it, that could be fun.
I'd just like to know, what are you trying to accomplish with your social media campaign?
What are we trying to accomplish? I mean, like I said, I think one of the big things is to get our science out there a little bit more. It's obviously also a tool to promote ourselves, our events. I think those are the two biggest things that we're trying to accomplish.
At the end of the day, does it have anything to do with membership? Like, for instance, getting the Academy's membership up?
I mean, from my perspective as a person that works in the membership department, I would hope so. I think a number of the people that are following us on Twitter and Facebook are already our members, though.
I ask that because you have a wide and broad ecosystem of people and organizations, communities of interest, and I suspect that they all don't want the same thing from you. And I'm wondering if there's any coherence or consistency in the branding that you're doing, branding of the Academy. And that has a, I don't know how you play that out, but I think that might be helpful to zero in on just what you're trying to do in terms of building your brand, getting out there to scientists, and then to people like me who, I'm not particularly interested in your collections, even though I find them fascinating. I go for the sustainability forms, and then I'm out.
I just wanted to follow up on Wendy's comment about engaging the people, because ultimately, you know, what I hope you're trying to do is serve your mission, which is, it says, is connecting people to nature. So, you know, the things that Wendy specifically mentioned are creating a very direct connection between people and nature and asking them to, you know, report that. So
Whereas, you know, driving more visitorship through the doors of the museum or more attendance at your forums is sort of an indirect accomplishment of your mission. But if you can always be, you know, thinking about how does this advance the mission of the organization? And, you know, I'd love to see, I don't know how much of an advocacy role there is in your, in the sustainability work, and whether, you know, calls to action, either direct or to partner organizations, to people in your social media streams are appropriate to take action on sustainability issues, but that's a good way to get people to work.
I'd also think about adding some games, or at least start off with a game, to what you're doing. I mean, the place is filled with game possibilities.
I don't know if you're familiar with two websites that do what you were talking about, engaging citizens in science. There's Citizen Science and the Cornell Lab of Ornithology. They have a really awesome website and a lot of opportunities for people to do so.
I'm going to state the obvious here in addressing your last question. When you're redoing your site and you're looking at your user experience, if you're really, if social media is going to be a very integral part of your marketing, make sure that all of your icons, the links, everything are very visible. People can find them. They're not buried down on the bottom somewhere. That's a mistake that happens a lot.
One other thing, I'd just like to add one about the seemingly obvious, but we'll mention this, but for social media, you know, it's about being social, which that's why it's, hence the name, but when you're putting things out there, if you can think of things that will invite interaction or invite engagement or conversation as part of it. So there's always, of course, you have things going on, so you want to put your announcements and, hey, we're doing this, but, and other people have, you know, mentioned this, throwing out questions or asking or just putting things out there that you feel, you know, could provoke, you know, that type of, people want to weigh in on it, whatever it is, that kind of thing. And so that, you know, that's what social media is really good at doing, is having that sort of thing. Even something as simple as, hey, we have a new video, what do you think of it? You know, I mean, that's a really simple way. But I mean, there's other many things that you can do that will just listen. But sort of actively ask, like invite the interaction. So, do we stop time or not? Where are we on the call?
3 minutes left.
Okay, go ahead. Nate, you're up.
So one thing the Franklin Institute does, at least on their special exhibits, like they had at the Cleopatra a while ago, they have in the whole exhibit, they maybe had 8 or 10 of these, but it'd be a little stand next to an artifact and say, you know, tweet or post on Facebook about this artifact with a certain tag on it. And, you know, if your friends use that tag, when they buy their tickets, they get, you know, 20% off or something. But it encourages you. I had no plans of taking pictures and tweeting about my experience there, but I saw the thing, and, you know, you're sort of programmed to do what you're told by science, you know? they'll tweet about this, I guess. And, you know, people can, that's a way of getting people engaged, or, you know, take a picture of the thing that you think is most interesting. Actually, I would go beyond that and say, welcome to the gallery of whatever. Take a picture of what you think is the most interesting here, not this thing. But, you know, find something, tweet about it, or post a Facebook picture, 20% off admission. Never.
Wait, but the users would get off?
Yeah, you follow the link, yeah. You tweet it, and then you.
That's a good idea. Yeah, right. I said, so getting people. That's how you're giving a discount to. I'm sorry, they were all good ideas. But that's interesting. That's right. So when people are actually actively in there, right? Okay. Are we wrapped? Is there anybody else? Oh, Wendy, go.
I was just going to offer, there's a woman, Nina Simon, who blogs under Museum 2.0. She's fantastic.
Nina
Simon, Museum 2.0. I mean, I find her relevant to things well beyond just museums.
I just tweeted a link of hers, specifically about Twitter, into the stream, but you can get the rest of it from there.
So, one thing real quick. Other things to explore are the check-in technology,
Foursquare
and Facebook Places and stuff like that. I think they're still, in some ways, kind of struggling to get a lot of traction, but
you can do some promotion that way. You give people, again, discount for checking in or whatever.
You've had 670 check-ins on Foursquare already. I mean, that's a pretty powerful base to start building off of. And that's with not even doing any promotion. So
when I see Gloria check in at the Academy of Natural Sciences, the next time I see her, I might say, hey, I saw you were there. What was going on? Did you like it? You know.
Okay, great. Thanks, everybody. That was very stimulating feedback, wisdom of the crowd there. And by the way, if you have other things that come into your mind, let's say after we're done, please come up and have separate discussions about what your thoughts are and ideas. Next up will be Phil Sumter from the Painted Bright Art Center. Just so you know, Phil has lots of flyers and info afterwards too, if you want to get from different things that they're doing.
So there's a PowerPoint presentation on a desktop. I'm not sure if you need to minimize that so I can populate mine. How's everybody doing? Thanks to Philly Net Squared for having the Painted Bride and me here. My name is Phil Sumter. I'm the Director of Marketing and Communications there. I have been a part of the Painted Bride's community since about 98, where I came on as a part of the marketing department. They offered me a job as I was exiting my graduate program, which happened to be in a totally different field, museum education, museum studies. So I've been other places, other arts organizations, but they summoned me back home back in August of this just past year, 2010. So I'm glad to be here, and I am still sort of trying to figure out, this wonderful world of the web and, how these certain web-based tools can be used to leverage your goals. I see there's a lot of people out here in the same sort of cultural arts and or nonprofit industries, and we're all trying to figure out the same thing. I think that there's probably a lot of people that could be qualified to stand here. I'll just disclaim, I don't know everything. I'm still exploring. I'm still trying to figure it out. What I have basically decided to do is to give you guys like a real brief, just a real breakdown on our mission. Well, to succinctly say what the Bride's mission is. I see that no one really raised their hand, so that must mean that most people here have seen and or been to the Bride. The Painted Bride Arts Center collaborates with emerging and established artists to create, produce, and present innovative work that affirms the intrinsic values of all cultures and celebrates the transformative power of the arts. Through performances and exhibitions, education and outreach, the Bride creates a forum for engagement centered on contemporary social issues. So that's what the mission statement is. And essentially, to follow up with what Denny already said, we do jazz, we do world music, we do dance, we do theater, we do visual arts, we have outreach and education programs. All of these things are very diverse. The roster of artists is, we go all throughout the world. You can have some presentation that takes you to Brazil. The next time you go to Argentina, you're jumping over to Tibet. You might have, somebody in your backyard you didn't even know. But the Bride is more than a venue. It's a community, and we welcome everybody. So basically, this evening I'm going to present and outline the Bride's organizational goals as far as using web-based audience development tools. That includes social media, and then I'll outline the strategies that we are focusing on to achieve these goals, which break down in three areas. Data capture, which is basically emails, call to action messaging through web-based tools, and then using online platforms and digital vehicles to drive traffic to the website, i.e. listservs, blogs, Facebook, Twitter, mobile tech software, the whole bit. So while I'm going to point out a few examples of each of these things, and then I'm going to go into a little bit about how to measure effectiveness, which I'm trying to get a handle on. Okay. Then there's some questions. That'll be in the 20-minute piece. So the goals. What is the Bride trying to achieve? To build, reinforce, expand the Bride's web presence by using web-based tools to drive traffic to thepaintedbride.org, the central hub for Bride-related information and activity, plus to have all the bells and the whistles there, and to capture patrons' attention.
The website is the intersection for a hopeful end, the intersection and or the hopeful end destination that basically converts interest into a sale or a membership or something, some next step. The second goal would be to engage our core audience, our friends, our followers in conversation. I think that social media is about a relationship and broadening that relationship so that we can have people come and be a part of our community. And I believe social media is that tool to use to achieve that goal. So it's genuine, it's personal. You know, if we have those people who we engage, who we know love us, we hope that they will post, tweet about who we are to their friends and their circles of influence to then increase our audience or our awareness or our attention or our ticket sales. So, data capture. We're aiming to expand our online presence again by capturing people's emails. And we have a number of different strategies that we use because basically, let's look at it. I mean, you know, there are a lot of people that provide you with a way to reach them and connect with them after they leave your space. But if you miss the opportunity to continue to capture those people's emails, then you'll lose them. And you've already made some type of connection. You need to continue to touch base with them. So you'll see the first means that we've been trying to employ is using an iPad. And when people come to a show or a workshop or whatever it might be, even if we're out doing some sort of community fair, we engage people with an iPad. Well, an iPad is—it's technology. It's Apple. It's sexy. People like it. We give people an opportunity to. Basically, we ask them a few questions, and we do it for them, or we can hand it to them and allow them to do it on their own. And what we do is, that data then goes straight to our listserv, which is basically what houses all of our data. So we can immediately start sending them messages. So it's a real quick survey, and again, either we do it or whoever we're engaging has an opportunity to hold the iPad and be able to enter their information. We say, hey, you know, it's not just staying in touch, but there's gonna be all kinds of special offers, and you know, you might win a pair of tickets, or there might be a 50% discount code. So that's one of the modes that we go in. I mean, it gets down to the, you know, the sexy use Apple and the iPad to, you know, enter the wind fishbowl where in the bathrooms people, you know, they're in there, you know, they see this bowl and they say, oh, drop in your business card. I mean, that's just another mode or another medium for us to get that. I mean, while it's not automatic, it's manual. We have an intern enter the name and the address, the email address. Some people aren't comfortable with technology, so we make it, you know, sort of simple. So that's in our bathroom. This is in the lobby. This is something that we also do, which this doesn't really have much to do with data capture, but kind of falls in the realm of how we engage them when they're on our site. If they're during intermission, they want to pull out their PDA, you know, we welcome them to check in. I guess that would be before intermission. And or tweet about how they're feeling about the experience. So that's projected on our large back screen. The audience is sitting down. They see that, and a number of other slides are rotating, which deal with other special events or the concerts or whatever we're doing. All right. The other way to collect email on the big screen again is join the Bride's E-Club, win a pair of tickets. We provide an incentive. So the two easy ways to sign up, use your PDA, sitting there right there, and you know, log on to this and sign up, or come and see the guy who's got the iPad. So there's two ways. We try to make it as easy as possible. Okay. At the point where they do opt in, we immediately send them an email that sends, you know, a thank you and, hey, the next step is, you know, we'd like to see you come through. Here's a 10% discount. And I see that I'm running out of time. All right, so non-sales posts. This is Facebook. And on Facebook, basically we're saying something casual, something that's sort of anecdotal, whatever. hey, the cupcake lady is in town, and she's right there in our parking lot. Come and get a cupcake. So that's something that's not really sales-driven, but as we were talking about what to tweet, what to post, what to say, that is sort of a light little, hey, guess what? Okay. In the news, the painted bride got covered in the news. We posted about that. And our Facebook and our Twitter are connected, so they feed through. Blog posts. I think one of the things about using social media is to provide cultural and social context to whatever it is your events are. We try to say, hey, you know, we've got Kunyang Lin, who is dealing with Far Eastern meditation. Let's talk about Far Eastern meditation and maybe say, if you want to check it out, hey. But it's not like, go buy these tickets. Blog post again. Ticket giveaway. You know, the first person to repost this, you know, is eligible to win a pair of tickets. See what you missed. Hey, we had this great concert. You weren't here. We wish you were here. Here's some photos. Take a look at it. Get a little closer to the next event. You decide. Cast your vote. We basically say, all right, we had a Halloween event. We had families in. We took photos of the kids. We had three categories of contests, you know, and then at the end, we had posted on our website the winners. All right, so those are some of the ways that, you know, basically we're trying to leverage the conversation, trying to get people engaged. And I think that it's working, but I think that there can always be, you know, room for improvement. I'm thinking out of the box. I'm thinking about having proxy bloggers, people that really are on our team, but don't really, no one else on the other side knows. Trying to get conversations started with our artists. You know, we ask the question, they comment back. Somebody sees that, they're like, oh, wow. But I'm finding that it's difficult to really get the comments and the feedback as high as I would like to reflect the amount of effort that we're putting into it. So I'm curious to see, you know, what other ideas or what kind of frequency, what kind of message, poignancy that we need to. So that is it in a nutshell.
Okay, great. Thank you, Phil. Can we show the sets of up there? Yeah, all right. Okay. So there was a lot of content in that one, and you can see the broads definitely very active in their various social media channels. So the questions that they have, what types of social media posts work best for instilling meaningful dialogue? How can we effectively encourage people to follow and friend us on Twitter and Facebook? And what kind of social media strategies or strategies are effective for getting people to do something specific, such as repost, retweet, or buy something? So, and again, you know, you don't just have to answer, by the way, Phil brought up a lot of things in his own presentation of what he's interested in. So if you have feedback that does not relate to these big questions, that's perfectly fine. So, who wants to start?
So what struck me the most is that you're doing so many different things. You're trying so many things, which is great. What I would recommend is you put in place something that measures quantitatively time spent in doing different things and the value, the return from them. Because at some point you're going to say, I got to stop somebody. You know, we got to cut down and narrow and focus. Like you said, what's most effective? To have, and it's kind of crazy how specific and how measurable a lot of the, you know, there are, everyone's familiar with Google Analytics. There's a whole other suite of social media measurement tools that can get very specific. And if you can track back the effort you put in and the reward, whether it's increased attendance or number of comments or whatever those metrics are, can help you focus and to do it the things that are most effective.
Do you have some recommendations on some of those tools?
The one, it's got such a dumb name, and it's so I forget what it is.
It'll come
in. Yeah. Like all these things, they have stupid names.
Yes,
it's sweet. Well, that's the problem. There's so many. It's that's moving.
Analytics Tracker is a really good one just to track all your measurements across the web, and they do have a free version. Yeah,
T-R-A-C-K-U-R.
it's saved in here, so of course I don't know how to spell it.
TRACKUR.com. Okay.
They have a free version that'll give you some good basic tracking on all of your mentions across the web, not just social media.
So it's integrated. Okay.
But that's just to...
Thank you.
I mean, and all, really just Google social media monitoring. There's tons of tools out there, and they range everywhere from free to $800 a month.
I was going to say, as an example of somebody that gets a lot of responses, you probably know the organization Creative Time. Are you familiar with their work?
It's called Creative Time?
Mm-hmm.
And that's a software?
No. That's an organization in New York, and they fund art projects, and they're socially aware, and they do advocacy, well, art projects that have an advocacy twist to them.
Okay.
So, and I think saying things that maybe are controversial or pushing the envelope or having a strong opinion get more responses, and I think through your work that's very socially engaged, you have a lot of opportunity there.
I was going to say, it seems like you're kind of pushing a lot of the conversation, and I didn't see so much of like what's coming back, and I wonder, like, the advice that we gave to the Academy of Natural Sciences, they were just asking, like, what do you want to hear from us, was probably really helpful for you. But also, I wonder if people are waiting for a show to start, do you show the tweets that they send?
We did for the family event. We had on the big screen our both our Facebook and our Twitter, and you know, I failed to take a snapshot to document that, but that was one event where we had PNC Arts Alive. They were like, how are we using technology? And that was a part of the program for that day. As far as during the event, do we have other events? We haven't utilized that type of tool.
It seems like a really good way to start people talking about what they love the most about Painted Bride, and you could do that in a couple of different, you know, on Twitter or Facebook or whatever, because you are doing so much. It would be helpful to hear what people like the most and what the Painted Bride means.
That's part of it. The tracking, the metrics, the measurement, I would sort of stop the things that aren't getting that type of response and feedback, and that's why I'm sort of shotgunning it. You know, and until I have those things in place, I won't be able to measure, but I'm looking to do that, so this is great feedback.
I see that you have 4,856 friends on your Facebook page, which is terrific, and in terms of growing that, we've had enormous luck with Facebook advertising. It's not, you can target really well,
yeah.
It's not that expensive, so one strategy we use that worked great for us is you select to have your ad appear on the pages of friends of your existing friends. So anybody who's connected to someone who's already a friend of yours would be likely to see your ad, and then you can target demographically and geographically
right.
as well. And you're only paying for someone who clicks, and then you do not appear to have like a welcome tab. So, you know, you can create a customized page on your site that is a landing page for people who click through, and it can have a welcome message and then an introduction and some, you know, like us now or,
sure.
you know, do this to win. So if you do an ad campaign, I would encourage you to have a customized landing page for that click through.
For the pre-show slideshow,
yeah.
Where you're trying to get people to subscribe via their mobile device, I don't know if it would want to test it with the lighting and everything, but if the next slide or part of that slide was a big QR code that people could scan with their phones that takes them to the website, then A, I think they're probably likelier to take action because at least if people think that that's easier than actually entering a URL. Although I personally find it a little bit harder because you've got to start with the camera and everything. But it's definitely way cooler.
Yeah.
And you can, you know, going back to Google Analytics, you can embed UTM codes, Google Analytics UTM codes into that URL so you can then track how many people are joining your list. Do that, I guess.
I was just thinking, I've been to the Painted Bride a lot. I really love it there. But I don't think I'm your friend on Facebook, and I don't think I've ever been to your website. And so I was sitting here trying to think, like, well, how do I find out about your events? And then I realized it's probably because, like, I have other friends who are posting stuff on Facebook or talking about it on Twitter or whatever. So I just wonder if there's, and I don't know how exactly you would do this, but try to find a way who are the people who are, like, really out there talking about you. And also in this town, it seems like there are people who are very influential when it comes to especially arts and culture. So just maybe sort of trying to, like, gather up, like, your top 10 advocates, even if it's just some random person who goes to a lot of art shows or somebody who's, like, a, you know, a popular artist, and just, like, sit them down and have, like, a focus group about what they think about your social media campaign. And if anything, they'll probably advocate for you more and repost stuff more.
Top 10 advocates online. Yes.
I'll add to the point that the gentleman gets made by QR codes. There's a service called EcoFiles that allows EcoFiles, ECOFILES, that allows you to actually do something similar to what you do with QR codes, but it's double text. So with SMS, so you designate something like text, this word to this number, and then as soon as that text goes through, it immediately bounces back content to my device. And because SMS is still more broadly used than QR codes, it also works on feature phones versus smartphones. There's definitely the possibility of having broader reach by using that type of service along with QR codes.
One suggestion I have, I was just taking a look. Your Facebook link on your website takes you to your Facebook page, but you also have a personal Facebook profile.
Yeah.
The profile is the one with almost 5,000 people. The page has, like, I think 18 or 1,900. Merge those two. Get all those people in the one place where all the information
is. A constant reminder, you know, to tell them to move? Or how do I do that without nagging the mess out of somebody?
Well, one is you need to put reminders up. The other is, it's kind of a long explanation. Catch me later.
Okay.
I'll explain
right.
it to you. The other suggestion I would have is you've got a lot of great content that you're posting on both your Facebook and your Twitter. I would start putting out a lot of appeals for user-generated content. Constant appeals to people. You know, if you were at one of our shows, or there was something you really liked, or, I mean, you've got a great building. Get people to snap photos of your building as they're walking by and curate all that onto your Twitter and your Facebook.
User-based content.
I just say to follow on to that, and as we said earlier, getting people. I think something that would tie into your campaign of the bride takes you around the world. You know, ask people where do you want to go? Where should we bring artists from to entertain? You know, to bring the culture to you. You know, tell us where you want little contests kind of things.
As far as their input on what programs they'd like to.
Right. You may have your schedule for the next 3 years locked in. We don't know. But at least, you know, get people to say, what, you know, who should we bring?
Right.
What artists have you seen?
I'll get to programming about that question. I'd like to see if they'd be interested in doing that. But I think it's a real good way to engage our audience here.
Yeah, I wasn't sure what you mentioned. I mean, do you do much with video?
Because
it's very visual. I mean, you obviously have music.
We
and
do.
Visual arts, too. So, I mean, you're the perfect kind of space in sort of putting that kind of content.
We have video that is post-show, and we have video that's used for promo of show. We were able to do, we had a salsa dance party, and it was an installment of four. And by the second, we had this promo populating YouTube and driving people to, you know, the website to find out more, and it was really cool. I mean, we were really happy with it. We also have spoken hand drumming, spoken hand percussion orchestra coming up, and we've done the same. We took like 40 to 15 minutes, cut it down to three, you know, and so, yeah.
Yeah, the medium, you know, certainly fits what you're putting out.
Do you have a YouTube channel for it?
We do, and we have some person who's no longer there who has the passwords and all that.
we can't
I don't know how to jailbreak it or whatever they want to call it.
You got to figure that out.
I know.
Anyway, anyone that had a jailbreak, YouTube,
send an email to Google. They'd probably help you out.
We have already, and we've never heard back.
That's fine.
Yeah,
we
do.
Join the Google for Nonprofits discussion list.
Yeah.
And the Google for Nonprofits staff who are active on that list are moderately good at helping people solve actual problems.
Okay, that's great.
I don't know where this fits in, but number one, thank you for putting the arts and the sciences together. I think this is a great combination. I love the painted art, Brian, and what you do. I like the way you push the envelope on all sorts of things. One of the things that I would love to see is, you know, 10 years, more than 10 years ago, there was an artist who used to use the U.S. mail system as his medium. He would create artworks that existed in, you know, they used that entire postal system across the planet as a medium for creating art. And, you know, well, that's been superseded by the internet. I'd love it if Painted Bride would commission an artwork that existed on the internet or use the internet as a medium for art, just instead of a canvas or, right, you know, clay or music, whatever.
Thank you. It's great.
The envelope. We are literally.
It was interesting to me how you're using the iPad as a sort of buy candy, you know, to engage with people. And I was just there on Saturday night to see Thaddeus Phillips. It was an amazing show. The energy was so high at the end, and I never saw the sign that said tweet. You know, I guess I wasn't paying attention. But what if you had a dedicated, laptop outside, so when people come out, they could just walk over, the Twitter stream is open, and they could just type in their reaction.
I so hear you. I mean, have something installed, you know, permanently and secured,
right,
would be great. And I think that, you know, if we had a lot of people's interest, it would be like, oh, wow, we can't really give everybody an opportunity. My thought was to go to Springboard and get them to sponsor us and basically get, like, 40 puppies and line them up. Just haven't gotten around to it. But those ideas are certainly in the mix. That's, you know. And the reason why it's sometimes hard, it depends on the show. Thaddeus wanted this space to be kind of sacred before you. But so there was no back projection. And we had that same thing with Yang Lin dancers, mm-hmm, Zakir Hussein, you know, we can't really, you know, push as hard as we, you know, we are, you know, a grassroots oriented and community based organization. We're not really commercial bells and whistles. I'm trying to see, you know, where I can get it in.
Yeah.
This lady here, was that the show sold out?
It was not. It was about 80%. Did you go Friday or Saturday?
I went Saturday.
Saturday night, we were about 80% capacity.
I asked that because I'm wondering if there are opportunities for you to generate revenue, and I presume that's something you want to do. I don't think nonprofit and making income is an oxymoron. Webcasting, is that an option?
Charging
for it, even if it's $10. For people who are in California or Seattle or Miami or New Mexico who want to come into the Painted Bride's content and see it, and would be willing to show out $5 or $10. I mean, this event here is being streamed. And
I think that is where a lot of things are going. We did have a conversation with a creative tech-based agency that has had success with that in other markets. We have a grant proposal in that is bringing together Spoken Hand, which is a unique ensemble of men who are drummers, and they have four different parts of the world and the traditions represented as one voice. Then there's a similar thing that's being done just with voice. So it's called Skins and Songs or something like this. And we wanted, because it's so global, to have it projected and have people sort of, but I need a big marketing budget to make that happen. I can't really just say expect, you know. So we're looking at it, and I think we even put in the proposal, but we'll see. But that is, I think ultimately the Bride only has 260 seats. You know, how do we expand and monetize beyond that, those four walls? I mean, that is something we're challenged to figure out. Thank you for that.
Okay, excuse me, I'm going to cut it here, but it looks like there's more chatter to be had after we're done. So save your thoughts, and also, Bill, what many variety of flyers and things about what's going on there. Now next, we have Monica Fonero, who's from the Charitable Heritage Foundation. She, too, has something that you can pick up afterwards.
Hey, hi everybody. As she mentioned, my name is Monica. I'm here with the Chemical Heritage Foundation. How many of you, show of hands, ever had to take a chemistry class in your life? Okay, so pretty much everyone. And how many of you, have thought about chemistry since you took that class? Okay, that's actually a lot more than I expected. So at CHF, we actually tell the story of chemistry. And we do that in a few different ways, broadly. The first way is we have a library. We have rare books dating back to the late 1400s, about 40 years after Gutenberg's printing press. We have first edition copies of everything that Sir Isaac Newton ever wrote. We're also a museum. A museum interprets all of our collections, which, in addition to the rare books, are over 17,000 artifacts, instruments, and written records. We also have oral histories. And in addition to our permanent collection, we have temporary exhibits. This is actually a photo from Elemental Matters, Artists Imagining Chemistry. It's a contemporary art exhibit that we have on display right now. In addition to being a library and museum, we're also a center for scholars. We have long-term and short-term fellowships that help keep us at the forefront of chemistry. So what exactly do we do? A lot of what we do right now is produce strong online content. I hope I'm not biased in saying that. We have a podcast that comes out every 2 weeks. It's called Distillations. We have a blog that's updated just about every weekday. And it's different staff members that make posts, and sometimes they have to do with our upcoming events. Sometimes it's a historic take on current events. So we had a blog post about radiation after what happened in Japan. We've had posts about the environment, the Marcellus Shale. We had posts about Women's History Month when that was going on. We have a magazine that comes out 3 times a year. It's called Chemical Heritage. And the picture on the left is actually from our History of Absinthe article that was really popular when I posted it on Twitter. And our website itself actually has additional content. It's a great resource for the history of chemistry. When the Bunsen doodle went up on Google last week in honor of his birthday, our website was 6th on the list of search results, and we actually got about 35,000 hits from that. So that's actually Robert Bunsen on the right-hand side there, in case you were not one of the 35,000 people who clicked on him already. So in addition to our online content, we also have public programming. We have a lot of events that we put on. The museum is open every first Friday from 5 to 8. That picture is actually from the April 1st Friday where we had the 3D artwork from Wasabi 3D in honor of the Philadelphia Science Festival. We do Science on Tap, which is a sort of drinking and talking about science event that happens with some of our partner organizations. The Academy of Natural Sciences is one of them. This year we launched the International Year of Chemistry in Philadelphia. We had a panel discussion that was actually overbooked. Over 400 people signed up for it. And we're participating in the Philadelphia Science Festival at the end of April. We have really 2 weeks of events lined up for that. One is a visit with Marie Curie. We have a storyteller coming in to kind of portray Marie Curie's life. We have Sam Keen, a New York Times bestselling author, coming in to sort of curate the Science Cabaret, which is going to be live experiments on stage, and the audience gets to participate and decide which ones they like the best. So in addition to all of these things that we do, we are also into social media, obviously. So I'm actually going to have Elizabeth pull up some of our sites. So this is our Facebook page. We update it about once every weekday, usually just because we have them on hand. I'll link to our blog posts and our podcasts, again, just because they are really good content.
We've also been interspersing with quotes by famous chemists like Marie Curie, and some quizzes, and we've gotten some very cool feedback on those. Some great, some not so great. I never quite know which ones are going to flop and which ones are going to be a big hit. And also, as a general rule, I do respond to any comments that we get. And recently, we've even had people unbidden post things on our wall, which was really exciting. We had the Smithsonian Archives actually posted something about some women chemistry e-cards that they had, and I was like, great, that's awesome, thank you so much. Twitter, we have a lot of the same content as we do on Facebook, but in addition, we retweet a lot of, you know, things that seem relevant for our audience, you know, chemistry current events, anything historical that has to do with chemistry. And then, you know, I'll respond to people when I remember to do that. It's kind of tough to keep up with Twitter, to be honest. And I also track our Twitter links with Bit.ly, so I have an idea of what people are responding to and what they're not. Actually, one of the most successful blog posts that we put onto Twitter was one saying that if you scrambled an egg, you've done chemistry. So really, like, broad appeal. We also have a Flickr page, and it's a mix of images from our collections and images from events that have taken place at CHF. And we don't really do much with them. We're not very strategic with it. They're just there. We have a YouTube page that's very much the same situation. We have videos. We don't necessarily do anything with them. Some of them are long, some of them are event footage, and some of them are more short promotional pieces. So that's our social media. So the good news on the social media front is we are growing. In the past 3 months, so since the launch of the International Year of Chemistry, our Facebook active monthly users are up 148%. We're at 817 right now. I know it doesn't sound like a lot, but for us, that's exciting. And our Twitter followers have increased a lot, too. We're up 31%. We have 977, so we're almost at that 1,000 mark. Now, that said, we have a lot of challenges that I am acutely aware of. One is we're catering to a really diverse audience. Only about a fifth of our Facebook followers are local, so they're not necessarily going to want to come to an event or will be able to come to an event. Some people have science backgrounds. I know this because they'll ask me things about chemistry and I don't know how to answer them. And some of them don't. Some of them are just, you know, interested because they think that we're doing important work. Name recognition. We don't have any. People don't know when they see Chemical Heritage Foundation in their friends' news feeds, what we are, right? Like, we're not the Red Cross. We're not self-explanatory. In addition, chemical to some people is a bit of a dirty word. And even though we're not representatives of the chemical industry, no, we deal with that perception sometimes. Another challenge is just that we have a lot of stuff. Between our events, our blog posts, our podcasts, you know, there's enough on our website alone that I could post self-promotional content every day, but I know I don't want to. So it's a little bit tricky to weed through and figure out, like, well, which things do merit, you know, Facebook posts or Twitter posts, or, you know, where do we differentiate? So that said, the questions I think Danny is actually going to cover. So I think that's everything. And I just want to say thank you, guys. It's really excited to be here, and hopefully now you know more about the Chemical Heritage Foundation than you did to me.
Okay, great. And I'll just reiterate, they have to have a great exhibit that was called Elemental.
Elemental Matters.
Elemental Matters. It's your first time to go to the Chemical Heritage Foundation, and it'll be an interesting time to go. So,
and it's free.
Yeah, it's free, and it's an art exhibit about the periodic table of elements, but it's all different types of art, you know, related to that. Okay, so now we have our three questions. So there we are. How can we promote our events on social media while also avoiding a steady stream of marketing and PR posts? That's another very common type of question or dilemma that people have. Other than posting good content, what else can we do to increase engagement and grow our following? Is it effective for organizations such as ours to live tweet events? And if yes,
which events. So, throwing up into the crowd. Is there anybody here who hasn't asked a question yet that wants to ask, first of all? Anybody? Nope? Okay. All right, go ahead.
Would it be safe to say that you've very deliberately engaged educational audiences from elementary schools up to history of science departments and at the university level, and that they know about your services and offerings, and that you become a part of that community or ecosystem?
Yes and no. Our educational programming actually took a hit a couple years back with the economy, so we don't officially have an educational branch anymore.
Yeah.
That said, we just hosted a video contest in conjunction with the International Year of Chemistry, where high school students submitted videos on different elements in the periodic table, and we got like upwards of 1,000 submissions. So people know that we're out there. Whether or not they're connecting with us through social media, especially the younger crowd, maybe not.
Okay. And then another thing that occurred to me, and this actually would apply to the Academy of Natural Sciences, is investigating the use of social bookmarking. So there are a couple of, you have delicious.com, mm-hmm. as well as you have vigo.com. And vigo.com has a particularly deep presence with the educational community. So thinking about how part of...
I'm sorry, could you spell that, please?
D-I-I-G-O.
That's different from
Dave? Yes. Okay. So, thinking about how you could, because you're so content heavy, and you said you have a lot of content, so figuring out how to post that content and put relevant tags on it that people can pick up, and then the social elements that these networks let you see other people that have the same tag, it would be an interesting way of also getting your content out there, but also having it well categorized.
Right.
Did you have a question?
I actually have a question, yeah. I'm actually really impressed, as you guys have a lot of really cool things. You're updating a blog on a daily basis, which is awesome. You're regularly participating, interacting with people on Facebook. You have a ton of different like outreach. A ton of different things you're doing as far as outreach goes on social media. So I'm kind of wondering, what kind of resources do you all throw into this? Because I want to know when somebody asks me, it's just you, like that's it? Or...
So I manage our Facebook and Twitter accounts solely. YouTube and Flickr are not really managed by anyone in particular, that's why we don't do all that much with them. And the blog it's a collaboration, it's a collaborative effort. You know, we have a lot of different staff members writing posts and editing posts, and it's a huge... it's a huge investment, really. And I think it's one of those things where it's tough for us to get a lot of feedback on our blog via our website. So the more we can get it out there elsewhere, the better, just to get kind of some sort of return on that. Because it is a big investment.
The video contest we did, that we've got 1,000 videos, I think that's a stupendous result.
We think so too.
And whatever you were doing to promote that, do more.
I mean, that's a really legitimate thought. I mean, that was promoted largely through the teachers of individual schools. We did something, this is before my time at CHF, but we did something involved with the teachers' conference, or somehow got into them that way. I mean, it's tricky a little bit because I'm not sure, like, should we be actively pursuing high school students as our Facebook friends? Do you know what I mean? Like, is that a little bit weird? I don't want to be marketing the kids if that's weird.
Even the ones that, like, participate in the science Olympiads, but,
yeah,
you know, not necessarily all high school students. There must be self-promoting nerds out there who want to...
Yeah, and I would say that that's the kind of marketing that kids need, because the food and the clothing and the entertainment companies are being shy about it, and that's not helping them very much.
Just two thoughts. They just had the Kids' Choice Award with slime. Do you know what the chemical composition of slime is? What a great way to get kids excited. I think that's one thing, is we have to make chemistry a little sexier. And the other thing that is really being shoved down everyone's throat is nutritional content. Calcium, potassium, what's the sodium? Those are all chemicals. So even a kid's page, an adult page on nutritional elements that are important for our body. Yeah. And the same thing with the teachers. You know, teachers out there need resources to go for these, you know, Pennsylvania education guidelines. So, again.
We have things on our website that are educational materials that fit the core curriculum or whatever the
right.
Standards
for the
core curriculum. So, I don't know. I mean, I don't know how to get that in front of them, is the thing.
Right. I'll give you an idea afterwards.
I just have a question. Who's your audience? I mean, who do you want to be your audience? You implied that, like, you don't want high school students. And I don't know, you know, like, that shocks me. I would think you want them.
Not that I don't want them. I'd say it's that I don't necessarily know how to reach them without being invasive. Like, if there's a high school kid in my museum, am I going to say, hey, join our Facebook? I don't know. Maybe that's what we want to do.
They like it. I mean, I don't know that they would consider it invasive. That's sort of the changing of the generations or whatever. Like what would be consider invasive and what they do.
Also, they're liking you, not friending you. So I don't think it has the same.
True. Quality. Yes, it's true. Yeah,
so it's very different.
Yeah. And if you're providing them with resources that can help them with their science fair project or whatever, then yeah, they won't. You know. There's a scientist who will answer questions on essays on Twitter to high school kids, then that can be a good resource.
As far as engagement is concerned, I would consider gaming, especially crowdsourcing. Mm-hmm. I just ran into FoldIt, which is about folding proteins, and they're using algorithms to help you fold proteins of various sizes, which then they're going to try and use to see how human intuition can be used as an enhancement to computational power in the folding of proteins and stuff. So there's probably a couple other things in chemistry that might qualify for that sort of thing. Be a way to engage people, not directly with CHF per se, but as being kind of like the central point and a thought leader in terms of what's happening with chemistry and a way to really get people involved.
You know, and you might try to get Google to, you know, periodically have some, you know, one of their little doodles there, you know, again, so that you can.
I don't think it has any process in mind. I don't think it works like that.
Yeah. Okay.
Is the blog not on the community page?
It may or may not be. From the home page, you can access it easily. If you're looking on a website right now.
Mm-hmm. It's there. It's just called it by the name. It doesn't say blog. It's periodic tabloid. So if you don't know what it's called,
that's all.
That
was great. Maybe that you might want to put blog or something. But you're right, people don't know what that is.
The blog is very difficult to find on our website. Our Facebook and Twitter are very hard to find on our website.
You addressed what I was going to say. Is I could not find your Facebook and your Twitter links on your website. The other thing, and this is kind of for everybody, something to really think about is have visible physical signs in your location letting people know. You know, make sure if you're sending out emails, make sure your Twitter ID and your links to your Facebook page are in your email signatures. And then there's links in any newsletters that you send out. And in your newsletters, encourage people. You know, hey, by the way, we're on social media. You know, don't throw it at them every time, but every, you know, third email with a little blurb saying, hey, join us over here. And, you know, physical signage. If you have a cash register, a reception desk, anywhere, a little sign. Here's our Twitter ID. Here's our, you know, hey, we're on Twitter. We're on Facebook. We're on, you know, Flickr and LinkedIn and YouTube.
Yeah.
Get it in front of people.
That's a good point. I've noticed more and more. I was in Portland, Oregon last week, and I've noticed the stores have these stickers on their glass that are, this is a Google place.
Yep. Foursquare.
In Foursquare, And those are cool because they make you think about pulling out your phone.
Exactly.
And going and trying to find that place. So it would be interesting. I think that's applicable to everybody that's up here.
Sometimes you have to go offline to get people online.
Yeah, that's true.
I was going to add, I also work at Penn Publication Services, and the bookstore, the Penn, they, on anything that they send out, they always have like a little F and a little like Twitter, like just that little square, and like they won't send out any like ad or any email or anything without those two little icons. And it's also on all the websites. Any of Penn's websites is always, I mean, it's not just those two, because like, there's a bunch of social media, but that's a great thing to use.
And you had mentioned something that was interesting. You said, was it something with the scientists or something? What was the thing that got all the activity? You said, oh, I'm sorry, the Smithsonian. I'm sorry.
Oh, yeah.
The Smithsonian, you know, posting on your...
Yeah.
You have an ecosystem of, you know, potential social media partners, I guess, or whatever you want to call it. I mean, even you could do, if you wanted to even do, I know you see on your blog, but, you know, guest posts or something or some kind of trades or whatever, or, you know, say, hey, you know, do you have some information? Just sort of encourage that, you know, amongst your peers, colleagues, associations, types of things like that. Or, you know, conversely, you know, you going on their sites, give them the idea, you know, that they could come onto yours. So everything right now you're talking about, there's things that, you know, it's things that you're setting up, but there's also things that you can do, you know, to be drawing people to you. So, for instance, you're commenting on blogs, and they put the name of yours, you know, it comes back to you. So there's ways that, you know, you're out there engaging, you know, so that it ultimately comes back to you. But it's not the same thing as just saying, oh, here's our Twitter, Facebook page, here, you know, that sort of thing. Okay. Yes?
I also think the more you can get people tagging themselves in pictures and tagging you, you know, I noticed on your website that you had some pictures of kids up there, and I think you have to be really careful with that. You know, and if people are tagging their own kids, then that's great. You've already got that picture up on your Facebook page. But if you put pictures of kids on social media, I think it's a bit of a no man's land right now of potential legal trouble down the way if you don't have consent forms for that, which is, you know, a really hard thing to do.
But yeah, that is a murky area. I don't know, because it's a public, it's one thing if it's a public space, but then, you know, but not quite enough. But yes, go ahead.
I have a question. So who contacts your website for information? Is it the academia? Is it the medical community? Is it chemical engineers?
Some of all of those. And depending through which channels they've learned about us. I mean, like, we have business networking events for mid-sized chemical companies. We have First Fridays that attract, you know, locals. We have environmental programs that don't really seem to share their audience with anything else that we do. So it's tough. We don't have a clearly defined audience.
We have multiple audiences.
Right? We have multiple audiences, exactly. Yeah.
And maybe this is for all of the groups, then if you had an audience that was high school students and high school teachers, I would urge you to have a resource page, and on the resource page have games. There's a number of chemical games that kids can play to learn chemistry, but it's, you know, it's not multiple choice testing and stuff. They're literally fun games, and there's also ones in your area too, and there's probably some art-related games as well that could be useful. If it'll at least drive traffic to your site and get people involved. The trick is to then have something else for them to do after that pulls them into whatever you want them to do, attend the painted ride or show up at the museums or whatever.
I was thinking of something. I know with the, you're not quite a museum, but, you know, oftentimes it used to be the museum, right, they have that book where you sign it, right, and then you say whatever you want to say. I mean, you could just transfer that to your social media. So, like, you know, as they're leaving, you know, rather than having that book where they write it, you know, suggest that they tweet or Facebook or something, you know, their comments, so that, you know, it just pushes it out there.
Yeah.
I haven't heard anyone say anything about donations or donations. That's amazing.
Yeah.
But is anyone, this is just a question, is anyone using like text to donate?
No, but there was a specialized campaign last year before I got there that was sort of based on the give what you can. You know, 100 people times $25 equals this, be one of those people type of thing right after the, you know, the Barack Obama online, you know, campaign that. So, but not on a consistent, ongoing basis.
And just thinking as far as a gathering,
that's development.
I was just at the LA Zoo looking at their new elephant exhibit, and there were little posters, maybe 3 feet by 2 feet, about if you love this exhibit, text to donate. So all around at different exhibits, right there were these signs, the little cell phone text to donate, which I thought was very, very, because you got the connection right there.
So text to give is a whole rabbit hole, but so three things real quick. Mobileactive.org is the place to go for information about that. For low volume donations, the ROI is really low. And third, interesting but with some usability problems, I think, are two Philadelphia startups that have a different, that it's not the same text-to-give model. It's mobile, SMS-based giving, but it's with a credit card rather than billing back through the card carrier. Venmo.com is one, and I'm forgetting the name of the
other. Zipwire, and it's XIP wire.
I think we have one more suggestion.
I was just thinking, there's a community radio station I was involved with that has tip jars on its site. And it's like if you like a particular, you know, DJ or a show, or but you could have that for different things on your site where people could tip by making a donation. And then I wonder also, piggybacking on the education stuff, if there could be like a collaborative AP prep part of your, you know, preparing for the AP Chem test, where people could... you know, you might want to talk to, I think it's the college boards that give the test and see if that would be okay, but there could be collaborative talking about different parts of the prep books and how you go through things, and, you know, it might really drive people to the site.
Oh, all right. Last one, go ahead.
That's it. Speaking of text, when you asked me if the painted platforms was sold out, I thought where you were going to go is I would definitely sign up to receive a text, you know, let's say 3 hours before a show, if there were lots of tickets left and you were willing to sell them at a discounted rate. You know, it's sort of like Philly Fun Guys, but that's on Thursday, but you would know much closer to the time.
Right.
I would love to know last minute, oh, I could get a deal on such and such at the Bride.
A mobile rush initiative. We mobile do have rush. One. I didn't get a chance to go into it. We use texting. We use broadtexter.com.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't have a whole lot of people, really. So we kind of like that falls through the cracks because we're hustling in other ways. But mm-hmm. but I think that that's a good idea. I mean, if we do it via our e-club as opposed to the broadtexter, probably a lot more response in return. Good call.
All right. This concludes our Arts and Culture Science Edition of Crowdsourcing Change. And thanks to our presenters here. Thank you. And as I mentioned, you know, they're all going to hang out. So if you have, I know a couple of you were sort of mentioning, I'll talk to you afterwards or whatever. So please come up. Have your private conversations. We have food that we do not want to throw away, and we all don't want to eat ourselves. So please finish off the food. And then I forgot my one announcement that I always, always give, so I won't forget it, which is after we're done here, we like to go out and have some drinks and good conversation and talk. It's always a lot of fun. So anybody who wants to come is invited. It's only like a couple blocks. And if you don't drink, it's fine. You can just come and just join our party. But it's just another way for us to socialize. And everyone is invited. Anybody who wants to come is invited. And we often have new people. So that's what we like.
Thank you for buying.
I also want to mention... that John took extensive notes as this was going through the different suggestions that were coming along. We were going to display it, but we had a technical problem with that. And the Twitter feed was the most active that it's been since we were here. There are dozens of links on there to useful sites and examples and stuff like that. So I have some promises we'll be able to catch the Twitter feed. We'll package it up. And then we'll send out the notes and the Twitter feed back out to everyone on the mailing list as our follow-up. So make sure that you, just the people who are in this room, make sure that you sign up, and we'll make sure to get out to you the notes, the Twitter feed, and the emails, and other contact information of the people who came.
Okay, and I just want to thank the crowd. What a great crowd we had tonight. I think almost everybody said something, but everybody was, I think...
Thanks to Danny for pulling this all together.